Last episode, we talked about long-awaited memberships to the S&P 500 Club, new tests for Apple's M1 silicon, and product announcements from our regular suspects. Check out this link here to get all caught up. Today, we'll share some Starlink highlights, brought to you by an epic AMA. China's move to the moon, Intel books up fabs all over the place, and just a few dreamy topics. You'll see. Let's fire up the dashboard. If Reddit were a food, it would be an everything but the kitchen sink deep dish pizza. But seriously, there's a little bit of everything on there. Lots of raw information and a few or a lot of people getting roasted. It's important for us to take what we read on there with a grain of salt, which is why when institutions set the record straight, it's pretty awesome. That's exactly what SpaceX Starlink engineers did with the recent AMA on Reddit. For anyone that doesn't know, Starlink aims to provide a constellation network for more affordable high-speed internet all around the world. Initially, they were launching this service with a little short of 1,500 satellites, but since then, they've applied for thousands more to be approved. Clearly, this is a colossal undertaking that will get better over time with no particular end date. Here are some of the highlights from the AMA. Engineers with the handle Dishy McFlatface were pretty vague about data caps, saying that at this time, they would not be applying them and ideally, they won't in the future either. However, they are an effective deterrent to prevent abuse of the system, but Starlink engineers say they'll cross that bridge when they get there. In the meantime, they have a lot on their plate, since in January, they were moving from a limited to a wider beta in just late January, giving users more opportunity to participate, though no bribes will be accepted for those looking to be among the first experimental users. And hey, they're hiring members for production and product design, as well as software engineers, to make all this happen. For now, the dishes will only work from each beta user's address, but some Reddit users who live on boats, yes, boats, asked if eventually they could still receive service while being completely mobile. The answer is a firm probably, as soon as they increase their coverage by launching more satellites and rolling out new software. Whether you're in a private plane or on a boat, it seems like Starlink is doing their best to make sure you're covered. It must be getting busy up in space, as China just sent its most ambitious mission to date, the Chang'e 5 to the moon. If successful, this mission will collect lunar samples, making China only the third country to achieve this goal. They're hoping to get a lot done in the next 23 days. And since the Chang'e's program started in 2007, their orbiters have been really busy. They've already got a rover up there, and the Chang'e 4's voyage made history by landing on the far side of the moon, collecting lots of data and pictures of unexplored areas. Very Pink Floyd. This mission will use a few different machines, like rovers and landers. The lander will deploy a sample return vehicle that will collect 2 kilograms of surface material before returning to the lander, where the samples will be transferred to a re-entry capsule, and the orbiter will return to Earth separately from the rest of the hardware, landing somewhere in Mongolia. There's a lot of moving parts here, and not only is this cool because it kind of confirms China's place in the space jam, but it'll also be the first time lunar samples have returned to Earth since the 70s. Back on Earth, there's another race going on, the wafer race. For all Intel's folly, they're not down and out by any means. And they've got lots of stuff in the works. Whether it's AMD, Microsoft, Intel, or Nvidia, they all have their own unique chip architecture. With only a few qualified fabs, booking time can get really competitive. Fabs take billions of dollars to construct and take a while to scale because this industry is so specialized. For consumers, it's telling when a company books significant production time because it means they've got a lot of products coming down the pipe. The industry wise guys at Soothsayer IC Insights have done some real number crunching, and it looks like the entire semiconductor industry swelled up by 13% in 2020, bouncing back from a shrink of 15% in 2019. Even with their manufacturing challenges, Intel is clinging to its leading position with $73.9 billion in IC sales, followed only by Samsung 22% later. Let me just lay this out. Despite that Intel has generated twice as much revenue as AMD, Apple, and Nvidia combined, it seems despite AMD's explosive growth in the past few years, they still have a lot of work to do, and fab bottlenecks might be something they want to look at. A relatively new player in the CPU game, player because it's games and you play games, yeah. Anyways, thanks to their work with Apple, ARM has developed a new 10-watt CPU to power new Chinese gaming rigs. Backed by the China Electronics Corporation, or CEC, the PKS gaming PC leverages 64-bit ARM V8-based processors, the Phytium FT2000/4 chip. Produced by TSMC, this 1144-pin 16-nanometer process node has four FTC663 processing cores with three clock speeds ranging from 2.2 to 3 gigahertz. It comes equipped with 4 megs of level 2 and level 3 cache and typical consumption of only 10 watts. It supports dual channel DDR4 3200 memory, and these rigs are outfitted with 32 gigs of DDR4 and discrete graphics with dedicated 8 gigs of memory. I should mention again that this is a Chinese domestic product and will likely feature homegrown operating systems like UOS or Neo Kylin or some other Linux distribution. And if we're being honest, there aren't that many native Linux games floating around. There are some software suites like Crossover and Wine that users can run Windows games in a Linux environment, but it's not a sure thing. We're interested to see where this product settles, but it's looking like it'll find its place as an entry-level gaming PC in cyber cafes, where less graphic-intense MMOs are really popular. VR sims have been crawling out of the woodwork on Steam pretty steadily for the last 3 years, but today it's fair to say that they're actually a thing. DSAN Game Studios announced their single or multiplayer game Dreamhouse, coming soon to PC with optional VR support. It's pretty self-explanatory, but this game takes you through every phase of designing, planning, constructing, installation, and specific design interior details. They've even imported some physics to make calculations if you decide you want to remodel or demo a whole wall or two. It's developed on Epic's Unreal Engine 5, so visuals are solid. Get it? Solid? Because VR's not solid? But the VR will be limited to when your project is complete, so there's no opportunity to experience your space in VR during the actual creation process. It's confirmed there's native support for Oculus Rift, HTC Vive, and Valve Index, with compatibility for PlayStation platforms en route, but no word if that includes PSVR support. Given that Dreamhouse uses UE5, we'll assume its release is going to be late 2021, but there's no confirmed date set. You have just a couple weeks left to enter our Epic Code Red. This giveaway is one AMD Ryzen 5000 custom workstation to one lucky winner. Entering isn't hard, all you gotta do is hit the link in the description to get entered. But to make sure you're eligible for the prize, please like and subscribe to our channel, follow us on social media, and please check out our products at monolithgroup.ca. I'm Paul, this is Dashboard, and we'll see you again.